Welcome to another episode of The Profile. My name is Gary Dunn, and I'm your host with the most. On this show, we typically find out something we don't already know about our guest. And our guest this week had a bit of a midlife crisis that entailed selling everything he had. He then moved to France. He became an international star of sorts. He had to come home for personal reasons, just as it was starting to happen for him. So this week on the couch, we have none other than Mr. Frank Genovesi. How are you today, Frank?
Yeah, pretty good. Thank you, Gary.
Thanks for coming in. And I'd just like to set this up a little bit by saying I'm going to ask you a series of questions.
Mm-hmm.
We just want to get an insight, a bit of a snapshot into your life and
cool.
and your career. And the viewers are very interested in this. So first question, where were you born, mate?
King Edward, Subiaco.
Wow. Right here in Perth.
Yep.
And Genovesi, Italian?
You had, Italian, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Immigrant, just like myself.
Yeah. Born here, but my parents met in Perth.
Wow.
In the early 50s.
Yep.
And wacky-do, here I am.
And what instruments do you play, Frank?
Guitar, bass. I can hold my own on a kit for a while.
Yep. And obviously you're a great vocalist.
Some reckon I can sing, yeah.
Yeah, well.
That's nice of them.
I reckon you can sing, so. what is your main instrument then?
Vocals and guitar.
Yeah.
And bass.
And so.
Just depends what's required.
How did all that come about? What was the thing that made you say to yourself, wow, I'm going to do this for the rest of my life, the passion?
It's when I was a kid. I used to wake up to the sound of my older brother playing guitar. He'd be belting it out.
Yeah.
Typically occupy the bathroom for the best acoustics and let rip. It was like he knew he didn't need an alarm clock in our house. And he was pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's very good. And
is he still playing?
Not professionally, but the talent's there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And and I heard it and got influenced and thought, yeah. And I just picked it up.
Yeah.
Always have. Since yep. then.
In the 80s, I think your first foray overseas was driving, I think, from West Coast to East Coast in USA and
yep.
ending up in New York. Can you give us a bit of an insight into the trip and exactly what happened to that part of your life?
Yeah, no worries, Gary. I went to San Francisco. I went with the backpack, thinking I'll just go to America, have a bit of a look around, have one of those one-year around-the-world trips.
What year was that?
This was September 89,
yep.
when I left and lobbed there. And I thought, oh, this is awesome. I bought a 1966 Buick Electra 445 big block just out of San Francisco. Did Highway 1 down to LA.
Yep.
I was feeling very free and happy. And I spent a bit of time in LA. Then I just kept going. I did all the southern states through Texas down to, just the Gulf.
Yep.
Across Alabama, Mississippi.
Were you playing during that period or you had a band? Or?
Well, I bought a, like I said, I arrived with a backpack.
Yep.
San Francisco, I bought a little Yamaha 50-watt amp combo. Yep. Bought a Squire Strat and I'm an idiot. I should have kept it. It was Japanese. It was actually a really good guitar. Did hundreds of gigs with that over there. It was good.
They were really well made in Japan in those days.
Yeah, it was a ripper, a really good one. And I bought a mic and a stand, and I thought, that's it, I'm in business. And I would just stop, like I'd be in places like Atlanta,
yep.
Georgia. And just I played in Ventura and California. I didn't do a lot of performing along the way. I was mainly just yee-hawing and picking up hitchhikers and doing my share of drinking, waving the flag.
As you do.
Bit of a yobbo. But I had a great time. It was a great road trip.
Yeah.
And ended up going all the way down to the tip of Florida, down the Florida Keys, to the southernmost continental point, which is Key West.
Yep.
And I effectively drove up to Chicago, which is a long way. That's kind of like, I guess, saying from Albany to Darwin or something. Mm. So I did east-west, and then sort of south to north. Then I flew to New York.
Tell us what happened in New York, Frank.
I had a cousin in Queens.
Yep.
Just one of the boroughs.
Yep.
Queens is a bit like South Perth. you just sort of cross the river and you're in Manhattan.
Yep.
So you can take the tunnels or the bridges. And my cousin John's a singer, plays a bit of guitar, and he's an actor. So he was arty, and he said, well, you can stay. So I thought, great, because I was only popping in for a visit.
Yep.
And I'd go out at night, and in the apartment, you'd go downstairs, and in the local neighbourhood, there'd be plenty of bars and live bands. So the vibe in this residential area was a bit like living in Leederville or Mount Lawley, where the cafe strips are.
Yeah.
But just a lot more happening, like multiple times.
Very quick.
What we might realise here, just in terms of the amount of population and the vibe. And so you could walk along the street in the right neighbourhood, if you're musically inclined, and you might have six or seven bars within a few minutes walk.
Yeah.
And so I would just go out at night and go and listen to the bands, and I'd go and say hi in the break, and they'd hear my accent. And
there's an Aussie.
Yeah, and some people are pretty dumb over there, man. they'd say things like, so you're Australian? I go, yeah. And they say, but you look Italian. I go, well, yeah, I was born in Australia, but my parents are Italian. An Australian Aussie. I didn't know he could get that. Okay, yeah. It was kind of weird, but it was good. And they would invite me to play and get up and do a song, and I'd get up and do a song, and they would just be like, wow, please come back. And
wow.
They'd take my number, and before I knew it, my phone was running hot.
Or it's amazing.
My cousin John's phone was running hot.
Us Aussies punch above our weight, don't we? Always. No matter what we do and where we are.
Well, often. Yeah. Often it's true. But it was good. So, you know, I made a few bucks and I was able to eat.
Yeah. Just talk to the viewers. Don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel. And that's if you subscribe to it, you'll find out what's coming up next week. Okay, I'll just go to a few questions now.
Yep.
What was the first concert you went to?
I think it was Fleetwood Mac.
And what, in Perth?
Yeah, Entertainment Centre.
Entertainment Centre.
15, I think.
Yeah, I think they came across the road to Gobbles like everyone else. Last concert you went to?
Robbie Williams. My wife wanted to go to see Robbie Williams. I said, sure, he was good.
He wasn't drunk or?
No. It was a different Robbie Williams. It was all swing. It was his swing tour.
Oh, right.
So it was had that big band vibe. It was great.
He's a great performer, isn't he?
Yeah.
Mm. And the first single you bought?
I think it was Far, Far Away by Slade.
Far, Far Away, something like that, is it?
That's the one.
Oh, I'm not a good singer. The first album you bought?
I think it might have been Electric Ladyland, Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah, fantastic.
It was about 14 or whatever.
That changed the whole thought process of music, didn't it?
Yeah. Awesome.
The last album you bought?
Albert Collins. Yeah, I just...
Jazz player?
No, bluesman.
Oh,
bluesman.
Sorry.
I saw him at the concert hall maybe 10 years ago. Really good. Call him the master of the Telecaster.
Mm.
Yeah, he's just good.
It's great. You go to see a concert and, I mean, the artists are there to sell themselves, obviously, and it's a winner with you because you go out straight away and buy the album. Which is what it's all about as well.
Well, I went out and bought the album 10 years later.
Oh, did you?
No, it's just a best of, but it's just great. Just takes you back to those early days. Great recordings, you know, just good stories in the songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, pretty funny, some of them.
So what would have been your earliest influence as a musician? What bands did really captured your imagination?
I loved Status Quo, Zeppelin.
Yeah.
I like the sort of guitar bands of the 70s.
Yeah.
But I also enjoyed a lot of other music too, you know. I was big on Elvis and, you know, I like Dean Martin, man. And,
fantastic.
I like opera.
Yeah.
You know.
So, you like anything? You love music?
Maybe not anything, but I'm pretty broad
in my
taste, yeah. I'm pretty tolerant.
A bit sideways here. Other jobs, you, as musicians, we all... need to supplement our income or non-income. So what did you do during the day?
Back in my 20s, I was a driving instructor.
Yep.
Had my own driving school. I inherited that idea from my mum, who was a driving instructor.
Yep.
And that was really good because I could just do my own thing and I could even go on tour and whatever and just tell my students, closing up for a month, bye. It was all right. And later in life, when I got back from the States, I did some telemarketing for a financial planner.
Yeah.
And he got called away, he had to go and do something. He said, I think you could be pretty good at this. And he introduced me to someone. I ended up becoming a financial planner at age 30. Did it for about 10 years.
You had your own business, didn't you?
Or? I did, yeah. I had a great business, yeah. In Adelaide Terrace and later in Freo.
Wow.
Really enjoyed it. It was good. Learned a lot.
So I mentioned at the start of the show that you had a midlife crisis and you sold everything and started your second foray overseas, I presume.
Yeah.
And that I think that was to Europe and France. Can you tell us why France and and then what you did during that period?
I was knocking on the door of 40 after getting back from the States, doing about 10 years working hard, day gigging, doing the financial planning thing. I was still playing in bands, but nowhere near as seriously as previously. And I was going all right. I'd made a couple of bob and I was pretty happy. Well, I thought I was happy, Gary, but really I just wanted to be a muso again. That's the real me. Right. So I thought, I think I'll just turn my back on it all. So I pretty much sold everything except my gear.
Very courageous.
Which is very crazy, maybe. And I shipped about 15 or 16 guitars and a few amps and all my studio gear over to France. And I found a farm about an hour and a bit out of Paris.
Uh-huh.
And I set up a recording studio. It was a 200-year-old farmhouse. It was really cool. It was a working wheat farm.
Wow.
And it was great. I had what I always wanted, peace and quiet. I went there because I couldn't speak French. And I thought, well, if I go somewhere where I can't speak French or I can't speak the language, economically I'll be...
That surprises me because isn't your wife French?
My wife's French, but I couldn't speak French.
She never told you how to say ah-ha-ha?
Well, ah-ha-ha doesn't get you too far. But yeah, so look, it was a crazy plan, but there was the madness behind it. It was premised upon me not wanting to be of value economically to anything except the music industry.
Yeah.
So I put myself in a position where I couldn't be tempted to go and get a job unless it was washing dishes or something. So I thought, I can't go out and do anything because I can't speak the language. I learnt it pretty quick, but when you get there, you're pretty much relegated to the bottom of the...
Yeah.
It's like being an immigrant to Australia, you can't speak English, you know, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
You haven't got a lot of choices. So I just stayed home all day, wrote and recorded and shopped the music globally.
Music is an international language, so...
Well, the music is, yeah.
Mm.
And I would just do it, you know, pretty full-on. I just approached it as a full-time job. And
Tell me what happened with some of your music? With that?
Yeah, not a lot. Not a lot.
That's why you're sitting here.
Yeah. Spent a lot of money on postage stamps, sending CDs out all around the world. But I used to subscribe to tip sheets, which are... For those who may not know, just they're effectively leads.
Yeah.
And you would scour through the lead and you'd try to find something that you could match something from your catalogue to.
Yes.
I've got a couple hundred songs, so I thought, that one might work. And I was trying to get... I nearly got a song into a Tommy Lee Jones movie, actually.
Wow.
That was cool. Yeah. Very nearly. Director wrote to me, he said, great song. He goes, it really suited the scene, but... can't remember what it was, but we couldn't use it because blah blah blah. And I thought, okay, that would have been nice. But that's all right.
How long were you there?
In France, nearly 2 years.
And the year you came back here, obviously you left France.
I came back in the middle of 2004.
Yep.
So I was gone during the 2 years process. This is all ancient history now, mate.
Yes, mate. Our viewers are interested.
Well, I'd never really tell anyone unless it happens to come up.
Okay. Who are you listening to on the way here in your car?
97.7 Classic FM, which is all symphonies and things like that.
Wow.
About 5-6 weeks ago, my son put it on, and I just can't bring myself to change the station, and I won't let anyone change it. I've become a bit hooked on it.
And so your
son... Very relaxing.
Your son likes that sort of music, or he just...
Apparently.
Yeah. How old is...
He's 11.
Yep.
Well, he just likes, he's listening to Macklemore.
Wow.
In his mum's car. When he's in my car, we're listening to symphonies. It's really good. You learn a lot.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's good.
Favourite band of all time?
Oh, there are many, but I'll go with Deep Purple.
Deep Purple?
Yeah.
If you were to know you were going to be on a desert island, isolated, and you had a little bit of time to think about what album you'd take or what music you wanted to listen to, mm-hmm. what album would that be?
I've got a pretty cool double greatest hits of Stevie Wonder. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, just simply awesome. Might bring that.
You never know when you're going to be on a deserted island.
No, you never know.
Yeah. The best Perth band you saw live?
Might go The Boys.
The Boys?
Yeah. Fantastic. Musically straight ahead. Not rocket science, but just so tight. Don't think I ever heard a mistake. Just electric. And they were just kids.
Yeah.
You know, imagine if they had stayed together another 10 years.
Yeah, would have been fantastic. Mm.
They were awesome.
Yeah.
It was a great vibe.
Obviously, Paul McCartney writing the songs. And
excellent. And, yeah. Excellent writer, Paul.
And they were on Countdown as well, and did WA Proud. Yeah.
And they proved you could transition from a cover band.
Yes.
You know, the nemesis of Perth being Cover City. Yeah. But they showed you could take it to the next step if you were good enough.
Yeah.
And you had the songs and the delivery.
Like
and
anything.
And they did it.
Like anything, you cut your teeth on learning how other people do it, whether you're a soccer player or whatever you do in life. And,
yeah. And credit to Greenzo too, for the boys.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And so what Perth bands did you play in?
There's been a few. No Exit. I lost my virginity with No Exit as a band. I was age 14, played with those guys till I was about 19. We were all good friends still.
Yeah.
And we were doing supports for The Boys and The Fingerprints and others back in those days, late 70s.
Yeah.
Then I was in a band of masked men called Rumpelstiltskin.
Mm, I remember that.
Yeah, and I did in that band was play rhythm guitar and sing backing vocals, but yep. That was good. From there I went to the Sensational 60s, which was a rather lavish affair.
That was a Dave
compared
Warner.
To what else was going on
was
at the time.
Was it a David Warner thing that...
Yeah, that was Dave Warner's brainchild.
Yeah. And what was the other gentleman?
David Zampatti.
That's right.
It was the two Daves put that together.
Yeah.
A couple of clever guys.
David used to have something to do with the Rock Exchange maybe or somewhere with Des, Joe's and those guys.
I don't know, but he did manage The Boys prior.
Oh, that's right.
Since we mentioned that. Yeah.
A bit more leg space there, Frank.
Yeah, is that good? Is that good to you, Dave?
Tibia or
something. I'll get you get me. And a bunch of bands and Frankie Hurst and the Renegades.
Yeah, great band.
Yeah. Flingle Bunt.
Yeah.
Was a bit of a little cult thing. Three piece, I played bass and vocals and that.
Yeah.
And a few more, yeah.
Yeah. I'll just put my legs like this if you want to just stretch.
You can put them out if you want, mate.
No, no worries. So, your favourite TV show growing up?
Oh, gosh.
I have to ask these questions.
Yeah,
the producer keeps looking at me like,
I was
that one?
I'm going to say F-Troop.
F-Troop?
Yeah, it was just funny. Stupidly funny. Yeah, loved it. Get home after school. And
Mr. Palmer.
Yep.
Very good. Jane and Corporal Agarn. And
awesome.
Yeah. Sergeant O'Rourke.
That's it.
I remember those things. Okay. What does the future hold for you, Frank?
Well, just crystal ball. I think I'm going to be playing music till I drop, Gaz.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's what I do. It's who I am.
And
whatever else I do, that'll be right smack dab in the middle of it. And I'll probably remain in business. You know, I run an accounting practice and I wheel and deal. But music is it. Music and wife and kids.
I've got to give this another plug, and I seem to be doing this often. we're doing the Pub Legends.
We are.
And Mr. Al... Simpson organised that for us. Yeah. Have you seen Al lately? Or?
Oh, no. Al and I, we don't talk.
You don't?
No. I do see him, of course. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
So he's given you instructions on what to do? And
He's very good, Al.
Yep.
Yeah, he's got a good head for these things. I think it might be a future in the production side of things for Al, but who knows?
Well, I'm really looking forward to you coming on board and joining the group, and we're having a great time doing it.
Yeah, I am too, Gary. Yeah, it'll be good. You're a great guitar player too, man.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
I used to like going to watch Hooker and PJ Hooker and Gobbles.
Yeah.
Staggered in and out of there a few times in the day.
If you could get off the sticky carpet, you could get out of the place, couldn't you?
Great stretch sound there.
So, what unfilled ambitions do you have? Is there anything there musically?
Musically, I'd like to get the third album out.
Yep.
I've got two.
Did you bring your albums in for us to...
No, I didn't.
You could have given them a plug.
That's all right. They're not for sale anywhere at the moment, so that's all right.
Well, you know, here at ProCopy... you know, Mark can certainly...
Absolutely. And I tell you what, I saw on Facebook a couple of days ago our local great writer, Paul McCarthy, who you just mentioned a few minutes ago, he did something very wondrous and generous, and he's basically putting his catalogue on SoundCloud. And
wow.
It's pretty cool. You know, I might follow suit. Just put them out there.
Yeah. It can't hurt.
If someone likes one, that's fine.
There you go.
If they don't, it doesn't matter.
That's right.
No point
hiding them away.
No, just put it out there and let people worry about it later.
I wish I had some stuff to put out there. So.
You don't write?
I do, but didn't.
Just get it down, man.
Yeah, okay.
Get it down.
I'll come over to your place. You still got your...
It's all packed away, but
we'll get it
out. Could unpack it.
Yeah.
We could.
Yeah.
We could.
Let's make a date. Okay, we'll talk about that after. Do you collect anything? Is it...
Guitars, got a few.
Yeah.
There's 18 of you.
It's about normal.
It's about normal.
I mean, it's never as many as your wife's shoes, probably. You know, there's probably...
If I buy any more, I get in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I got some nice ones. Nice enough.
Can you tell us something right now that none of us know about Frank Genovesi? Something out of the box?
I can play songs on my teeth. Popcorn. How good's your mic? That's not working very well. But you get the idea. Could you get it?
Yeah. I love that.
It wasn't a very good rendition, so haven't done it for a while.
You had a go. That's great.
Got to have a go.
Okay, probably a quirky question. What would you put on your gravestone?
Ooh, shook the tree.
Shook the tree?
There you go.
See what fell out?
Gave it a shake.
Excellent. Look, do you want to ask me any questions? I'll give you one question.
One question, okay. You got me here. What's your favourite all-time movie, Gary?
My favourite all-time movie would have to be Blade. I think it was called Blade Runner.
Blade Runner?
Yes. And where they sort of had these eye things.
Yeah.
Was that a futuristic movie?
I think. I know Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Love that movie. So.
When we were teenagers, when it came out.
Yeah.
Saw it at the movies.
I loved the bit where he had a dove and it was raining and he was dying. And he let the dove go. And he said, I've seen things. Oh, I can't even remember what the line was, but gee, I'd be hopeless if you're interviewing me, mate.
That's all right.
Look, Frank, I really enjoyed talking to you.
I had a good time. Thanks, mate.
Really appreciate you coming in and just giving us a bit of an insight and a snapshot of your life. And look forward to playing April 29th in the Pub Legends.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And, I'm only going to do one song with you. Bit of a bummer.
No, I'm only one. No, how many songs are you doing on the night?
Oh, no, you're playing all night, aren't you?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm only doing one with Gardy.
Alan Simpson gives me half pay and then makes me do double the
work. No, we'll have a party then, you and me.
So I just want to tell the viewers, if you're happy with what we're doing, give us a like. We love likes. on this show. And last thing I'd like to leave you with is a little quote. To be able to look back upon one's life with satisfaction is to live twice. Thank you for joining us. Have a good week.
I sit here in my room, gazing at your photograph on a sheet of black and white, but still your colors come to life. Ain't got much to do, so I just try to laugh, to cast all my hurt aside. Seems another time to hide it all from you. Never let it show through. Oh, and the other day I saw you, I had so much to say, the words were all choked up inside. I had so much I wanted to tell you, but I'm not out to bore you. I know you've gone your way, but please can't you realize that I can't help but love and adore you. I'm hiding it all from you. Never let it show through. Is it necessary to be so totally apart? Why do we have to break each other's hearts? You must be stronger than me, I can tell by the things you do. I wish I had the guts to face right up to you. Photograph your long soft hair and shiny eyes makes me think of all the fun, the joy, the warmth, the sad cries. To delve into the past probably won't help me now, but I'm enjoying my thoughts of you, and I can't help it anyhow, cause I'm hiding it all from you. Never let it show through. Hiding it all from you. Never let it show through. I'm hiding it all from you. Never let it show through. Oh, I'm hiding it all from you. Never let it show.